Amazing. So last hour of television, how many of you marathoned the OC leading up to this? How many of you are now going to go home and marathon the OC after watching this? And where are you guys going to watch it? CW Seed? Great. Good job. I'm hoping that they're going to come out when I call their names. So, playing the role of, get ready, Dawn Atwood, Lynn, Mrs. Donnelly, Holly Fisher, Newport Woman 1 and 2, student PA, and Nikki is Catherine Willis from Friday Night Lights. And playing the role of Trey Atwood, Caitlin Cooper, AJ, Waiter, Newport Dad, Bob Coughlin, and Keg Bro, Nick Benzman. Playing the role of Julie Cooper, Fashion Coordinator, and Nordland, Stacy Oristano. Playing the role of Luke Ward, Newport Woman number 3, and Betsy, Nick Wexler. And playing the role of Summer Roberts, Matt Loria. Playing the role of Marissa Cooper, Patrick J. Adams. Playing the role of Seth Cohen, Mae Whitman. Playing the role of Kirsten Cohen, Anson Mount. Playing the role of Sandy Cohen is Ashley Williams. And playing the role of Ryan Atwood is Ariel Kebble. Reprising his role as Jimmy Cooper, Tate Donovan. To read the stage directions, Josh Schwartz.
The part I was born to play.
Hi. Thank you guys for coming.
Check, check.
So the non-actor is going to be reading the majority of this. Okay.
I'm so excited to be Ben.
It's a natural. Okay. The OC. Act one. Exterior, Chino City Streets. Chino? Anyone? Okay. Night.
It's what's up.
Two figures stand over an old Camaro. One of them, the older one, wild-eyed, arms riddled with tattoos, holds a lead pipe, grinning. This is Trey Atwood, 22.
I'm your big brother. If I don't teach you this, who will?
And with that, he smashes the window. As the glass shatters, the other figure, younger, hooded, trying not to look scared, jumps, glancing around nervously. This is Ryan Atwood.
I don't know, Trey.
Well, I do. Now hop in.
He does, pulls out a screwdriver.
And pay attention. This is the fun part.
He pops open the ignition. Ryan moves to the passenger side, watching Trey hotwire the car as the engine purrs.
Yeah, I'm interested, but I'm gonna have to take it for a test drive. You mind if we take it off the lot?
Ryan is frozen at the door.
Quit being such a little bitch. Get in.
And then Ryan sees a police car turning onto their street, rolling slowly, looking for trouble.
Let's go, Ryan.
Trey's already pulling out as Ryan throws open the door, panicked look at the cop car, and then he jumps in. Exterior city street, interior Camaro moving, continuous. Trey peels out, and as soon as he does, the cruiser's lights come on. Siren wailing, Trey grins big.
Yo, put on the radio, man. You should see your face, man.
Ryan is paralyzed, pressed against the seat. As Trey tears through a red light, swerving from a car, he flips through the radio. The Chino City streets a blur, abandoned cars, darkened strip malls, desolate. Even at night, this place is gray. The police cruiser is right on their tail. All scored to snippets of radio promo. We'll skip that part. We didn't do that. Okay. Trey laughs, hollering like it's a ride. Ryan shuts his eyes. Trey comes up behind a bus. He leans on the horn. No luck. He swerves around it, heads into oncoming traffic. A pickup truck bearing down right on them. On Trey, the smile falls. He yanks the wheel all the way as the car whips onto the sidewalk, totally out of control.
No.
Trey jerks the wheel the other way, sending the car spinning, front to back to front to wham! The Camaro smashes into the telephone pole. That awful sound of twisted metal, shattered glass, hissing. A beat, almost peaceful. As Trey and Ryan both realize, they're alive. Look at each other, Ryan stunned, Trey impressed. And then the sound of a police officer rapping on Ryan's window, gun drawn. He gives him a wave. Off Ryan, eyes closing, sinking into his seat. Cut to interior detention center, cell block hallway, morning. Ryan in handcuffs and juvie issue coveralls is led down the hall by a guard. Interior detention center, conference room. Ryan is led by the officer into a cramped cement room. His face is a mask of false bravado. Sandy Cohen, 40s, seated at a small table, rises.
Hey, Ryan. Sandy Cohen. The court's appointed me to be your public defender. You could do worse. You all right? They treat you okay?
Where's my brother?
Sandy nods, looking through one of many manila folders on the desk.
Trey. Yeah, Trey's over 18. Trey stole a car. Trey had a gun in his pants, an ounce of pot in his jacket, and a couple of priors. I think it's safe to say Trey hasn't been a model citizen. I'm guessing 3 to 5 years.
Ryan tries not to react, doing his best to seem tough.
But Trey's not my concern. So, your first time in lockup, I'm assuming you don't plan on coming back. You weren't driving the new totaled Camaro, which helps. Your grades aren't great. Suspended for fighting twice, truancy 3 times, but your test scores, 98th percentile on your SAT ones? My son, Seth, he just took those, tanked them.
Bummer.
Yeah. You know, no, he's not a good tester, though. Start going to class. With these scores, you thinking about college? You giving any thought to your future? Any plans? Hey, dude, I'm on your side. Anytime you want to help me out,
Modern medicine is advancing to the point where the average human lifespan will be 100. But I read this article which said the Social Security is supposed to run out by the year 2025, which means people are going to have to stay in their job until they're 80. So, I don't want to commit to anything too soon.
Give me a moment alone with my client.
Yeah.
All right, look. I'll plead this down to a misdemeanor. Petty fine, probation. But know this. Stealing a car because your big brother told you to, that's stupid. And it's weak. And those are two things that you can't afford to be
two
anymore.
Two more things.
You want to change that? You're gonna have to get over the fact that life's dealt you a bad hand. Listen, I get it. We're cut from the same deck. I grew up, no money, bad part of the Bronx. Dad was gone, mom worked all the time. I was pissed off, stupid.
And look at you now.
Hey, I am serious. Smart kid like you, you gotta have a plan. Some kind of dream, or...
Yeah, right. Well, let me tell you something, okay? Where I'm from, having a dream doesn't make you smart. Knowing it won't come true, that does.
Off Sandy. Applauds. No. Off Sandy. Doesn't know what to say to that. Struck. Exterior Chino Hills Detention Center. Morning. Ryan and Sandy stand outside the building in the parking lot. Don't have a lot to say to one another.
So, my office will contact you to remind you of the date for your hearing.
Yeah, I'll remember. You know, you don't have to wait for me. She'll be here soon.
I have to release you into the care of a parent or guardian.
A banged-up Chevy Nova pulls in, driving a little faster than is safe for a parking lot. Lurches to a halt. Don Atwood, late 30s. Oh my God, I'm the same age as Don Atwood now. This is terrifying. Sorry. Had a moment.
Awesome.
She was once an attractive woman, but life hasn't been kind.
so beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Looks like she just got out of bed, not wearing shoes. And this we have in common, probably drunk.
Unbelievable. What a family I got, huh? What the hell did I do to deserve this family? You want to tell me that?
Ryan looks away. Sandy can immediately see the shame in Ryan's eyes.
Hi, Mrs. Atwood. I'm Sandy Cohen, Ryan's attorney.
You should have let him rot in there.
Oh.
Like his dad's doing, and like his brother's gonna. Let's go, Ryan.
She goes to get back in the car, smacks her head on the door frame, which sets off a litany of swearing. Ryan takes a deep breath. Looks at Sandy, nodding thanks. As he's about to walk to the car, Sandy speaks before he thinks.
I'm gonna give you my card. And my home number. If you need somebody. If things ever get to be too much, call.
Ryan shoves the card into his pocket, walks off, doesn't look back. Off Sandy, doesn't feel good about letting him go. Oh. Interior. Interior, the Atwoods' shitty house. Day. Just the side of a trailer. Just. Ryan stands, listening to Dawn's verbal lashing. She smokes, mixes a drink, sitting watching TV, her boyfriend, AJ, 30s, beefy tank top, not a nice-looking guy.
I can't do this anymore, Ryan. I can't. You want to throw your life away, too? I'm not going to watch it.
Look, I'm sorry, Mom.
I can't do it.
Don't, please.
I want you out of my house. I want you out.
What? Mom, where am I going to go?
You heard your mother, man. Get your stuff and get out.
Hey, this isn't your house, man.
You a tough guy now?
AJ, don't.
Yeah.
Ryan, get out.
You know what? Why don't you worry about your own kids, AJ, instead of freeloading off of my
AJ smacks
mom.
Ryan open-handed across the face. Ryan tries to hit him back. AJ grabs him, spins him, sends him down the hall to his room. This is ugly. Music up. Interpol's Untitled. Interior Ryan's bedroom moments later. Ryan, face red and stinging, eyes filled with tears, stuffs anything lying on his bed into a backpack. He grabs his beat-up BMX bike. Oh, it's a skateboard, actually. We change that. And gets the hell out of there, shoving past Don and AJ, who glowers in the doorframe. Exterior of the Atwoods' shitty house. Day. Ryan is out of the house, onto his bike. Oh, no, it was a bike. Wasn't it a bike? It was a bike. I take that back. It's been a while. And gone.
It was a payphone, though. They had those.
Yeah, they did have those back there. His mom watches from the door, quickly wipes away a tear. Ryan doesn't look back. Exterior, 7-Eleven day. Ryan stands in front of a 7-Eleven on a payphone.
Come on, pick up. Pick up.
Time cut. Ryan's still on the phone.
Oh, come on, man. Let me crash on yourself, or like your couch or something. Just anything, man.
Time cut.
Hey, Uncle Jeff. Yeah. No, I don't know anyone else. Please?
Ryan takes the phone, slamming against the cradle over and over, furious, scared, digs into his pocket for change, and pulls out the card. Crumpled and forgotten, flips it over. Off his luck. Exterior 7-Eleven afternoon, Ryan sits on the curb nervous, glancing up and down the street. The shadows are getting longer. And then he sees a Mercedes pull up. Ryan rises, takes his bag and his bike, approaches the car door. A beat, opens it. Sandy behind the wheel. He nods, gives a tight smile.
I told you could do worse.
Interior Mercedes moving. Exterior Chino, afternoon. Ryan's bike sticks out of the trunk, bungee cords holding it in place. Ryan stares out the window, watching the urban sprawl outside his window, a blur of gray. Off this view, somebody cue up California right now.
California,
here we come.
Exterior Newport Beach, interior Mercedes moving, sunset. A gorgeous sun-drenched evening, the ocean shimmering gold. A few surfers getting the last of it in before sunset. As the Mercedes rolls down PCH, Ryan still stares out the window, drinking in a panorama of Newport Beach. Ryan looks over at Sandy. Sandy catches this look. It's clear they're both nervous.
So, this is a nice car. I didn't think your kind of lawyer made money.
We don't. It's my wife's.
What does she do?
See this?
Sandy gestures out the window to the expanse surrounding them.
Her family built it.
All of it?
Pretty much.
Exterior Pelican Cove, interior Mercedes dusk. The imposing iron gates swing open to this beachfront housing community. A security guard in the booth gives Sandy a nod. curious as to his passenger. Exterior Pelican Cove, interior Mercedes, dusk. The Mercedes slows at a crosswalk. Ryan stares at the windshield, dumbstruck, as a golf cart rolls past them. Sandy's clearly a little embarrassed. There are golf cart crosswalks in a place he calls home. As the Mercedes drives on, winding up the street past mansion after mansion, none of them more than 5 years old, the rolling greens of the golf course, and beyond all that, the ocean. Exterior of the Cohen House, dusk, in a dizzying expanse of mansions, none looms larger than the Cohens, not understated in the least. The landscaping alone is jaw-dropping. For lack of poetry, this shit is insane. Sandy pulls the Mercedes into the driveway next to a Range Rover. He puts the car in park. Ryan goes to open his door.
You mind waiting here for a minute? I got a lot of splendid to do. No, that's what Ricky always says to Lucy. I'll be right back.
Sandy turns off the car, ready to pull the key out, stops himself, suddenly very self-conscious until...
It's no fun if the key's in the car.
Sandy smiles. Appreciates being let off the hook, leaves the key in the car and the radio on. Ryan alone takes a moment to breathe. Where is he? What is he doing? As he reaches for the radio, trying to find something from the 21st century.
You brought him home?
Reveal. Interior Cohen House, living room night. The most expensive everything, Spanish tile, leather couches, flat screen TV. This is a house where everything was acquired, collected over time, furniture, books, artifacts from all over the world. Kirsten, late 30s, classically beautiful, is just home from work, unpacking her leather satchel, pulling out papers, checking her BlackBerry. Sandy tidies up, arranging magazines, organizing video games.
This is not a stray puppy, Sandy.
I know that, Kirsten.
It was only a matter of time until you started bringing home felons.
Ryan's not a felon.
Did you not meet him in jail?
Okay. Technically, yes. But it wasn't for a felony. Or it was, but it won't be after I...
You are endangering our home. Did you even think of Seth?
But it's only for the weekend. Until Child Services opens on Monday. I want a third-party agency to sit with him and his mother. Clearly, she's not fit.
How do you know that? What if this is all a scam and he's using you to case our house?
He's not a criminal mastermind. He's a kid who has no one and nowhere to go. When did you become so cynical?
When did you become so self-righteous?
I've always been self-righteous. You just used to find it charming.
He sleeps in the pool house.
We have 4 extra bedrooms we don't use.
I'm not running a halfway house, Sandy.
Where are you going?
To put my jewelry in the vault. Where do you think I'm going? The boy's going to need fresh sheets and towels, a toothbrush.
Off Sandy getting a reminder of the woman he married. Exterior of the Cohen House, night. Ryan, bored and restless, gets out of the car, walks down to the end of the driveway, strangely quiet. As he glances from house to house, every driveway fitted with a Range Rover, he shakes his head and then shakes out a cigarette, lights it up, and looks to the house next door as Marissa Cooper, 16, comes outside. Walking down the end of her... Walking down the end of her driveway, anxiously looking up the street, checking her watch. As she gets to the curb, she turns, seeing Ryan. And the way the light from the street lamp above hits her, she looks perfect. Ryan has never seen a girl like this before. The girl is heartbreakingly beautiful, and she knows it. And truth be told, is a little embarrassed by it.
Who are you?
Whoever you want me to be.
I was so distracted by your beauty.
She smirks. That line doesn't work here. She looks back up the street. Ryan deflates a beat. She looks back at Ryan and then to her house. Coast is clear.
Can I bum a cigarette?
Ryan nods, almost too eager, pulls one out. As he hands it to her, his fingers graze hers. A quick look between them as he lights her cigarette. As he does, he breathes her in. I can't believe I wrote this. He's never smelled a girl like this before. I was young.
It's okay.
Marissa blows out her cigarette smoke a little too coolly. She's putting on airs here a bit as well. But to Ryan, she's all sophisticated grace.
So what are you doing here? Seriously.
I stole a car, crashed into a telephone pole. Actually, my brother did, and since he had a gun and drugs on him, he's in jail. They let me go, but then my mom threw me out because she was pissed off and drunk, so Mr. Cohen took me in.
Uh-huh. So you're their cousin from Boston, right?
Boston. Right.
Hmm. Suddenly Marissa sees Sandy coming down his driveway. She tosses her cigarette into the bushes.
Hey, Marissa.
Hey, Mr. Cohen. I was just meeting your nephew.
Oh, yes. My favorite nephew, Ryan. All the way from Seattle.
Seattle?
Oops.
By way of Boston. My dad lives there. My mom lives in Boston.
So we're really excited about the fashion show fundraiser tomorrow.
Oh, me too. It's been so much work. But it raises a lot of money for Charity League, so...
$200 a head, it should. And I can presume that the food will still suck.
You can.
Hmm.
You should come by. Check it out. You know, if you don't have any other plans.
Ryan shrugs, like he'll have to check his schedule.
You ready to come inside? Good night.
See ya.
Ryan tries another cool guy head nod. She does it right back to him. None of his moves work on this chick. As he and Sandy head up the driveway.
There is no smoking in my house.
Ryan's never heard that rule before, drops a cigarette, steps on it, and just as they're almost at the house, a four-door Yukon pulls up. Surfboard strapped to the roof, hip-hop blasting. Ryan gets a look at the driver. Luke. 17. Athletic. Blonde hair, chlorine bleached after hundreds of water polo practices. Marissa jumps into the truck. Luke nods towards Ryan. Who's that? She shrugs, they kiss, and Luke peels out.
Go for it.
Off Ryan watching her and Sandy watching Ryan. Interior cool. Interior Cohen pool house night. Hard to believe this is just the pool house. A sofa, fresh cut flowers, real art on the walls. Ryan is led in by Sandy. Kirsten watches as Rosa the live-in, late 20s, finishes remaking the couch into a bed.
So this is where you'll stay, and this is the queen of the manor, my wife, Kristen.
Hello, Ryan. Welcome to our home. If you need anything, Rosa here can help.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Really, thanks so much.
Well, see you in the morning.
That's my line. But you can say it.
So, thanks. Thanks very much. No.
She nods. Sees he's not a monster, per se. Sandy?
What happens? Oh, I messed this whole thing up. Right. Okay, see you in the morning.
It was a key line.
Nailing
we had to get in there.
Nailing
yeah.
it.
Okay. Ryan nods, a little embarrassed, intimidated. They walk out. Ryan, all alone, surveys this place. In the mini fridge, fresh fruit, bottles of water, the bathroom, the shower is a steamer and a seat in it, and soap that looks like seashells. Clean folded towels, a terry cloth robe hangs on the door. Interior Cohen guest house later. Ryan pulls back the comforter on the bed. Silk sheets? He debates getting in, but he does. Off Ryan, lying there, afraid to move, staring at the ceiling fan, a stranger in a very strange land. End of act one. Act two, exterior Cohen pool house morning. Ryan, groggy, steps out of the pool house in clothes that pretty much resemble what he wore last night. And suddenly he's awake. He hasn't seen this place in daylight. The grounds are huge, perfectly kept, enormous pool, hot tub. This place is sick. Interior Cohen home, family room morning. Ryan slides open the doors that lead from outside into the family room, and he stops seeing Seth Cohen, 16, sitting on the floor playing video games, focused on the flat screen before him. Seth, attractive but awkward, has not even begun to grow into himself. A little too much Peter Parker without enough Spider-Man. Well, Seth looks up, a long beat, as he studies Ryan.
Hey.
Hey.
Seth turns back to the TV, plays for a beat more, looks back at Ryan.
This is the new PlayStation.
I know.
Oh. You want to play?
Interior Cohen home, living room later. The two guys sit playing. Two bowls of cereal before them, not a lot of conversation, diligently focused.
Try using your sword.
No, I'm going back for the gold coin. You get more points that way.
Oh.
Interior Cohen Helm foyer, later. Sandy comes in the front door, bag of groceries under his arm, and he hears an unfamiliar sound, laughter. Ryan and Seth are really into the...
Oh, man, come on, use your sword, you got him. Come on, you got him. Oh, dude, hurry up, they're gonna kill us.
Well, how about a little backup?
Okay.
Both boys hitting the buttons furiously, to no avail. They throw up the controllers,
oh,
moan, yell, they've lost.
Dang, man. You wanna play Grand Theft Auto? It's really cool, you can steal cars. Not that that's cool. Or uncool. Or,
I see you two, Max. What are you doing sitting inside? It's beautiful out. Seth, why don't you show Ryan around?
Yeah, Dad, because it's so great here. There's so much to do. Unless, I mean, what do you want to do?
I mean, like, what do you guys do around here?
Smash cut to exterior Pacific Ocean day. Catamaran sailboat skims across the ocean. Manning both rudder and sail is Seth. In total control, giving us a glimpse of the confident guy he could become. Far less comfortable, okay, totally freaked out, is Ryan. In tank top and dickies, he ain't sailor material. The boat is already almost on its side. Ryan holding on for dear life is dangerously close to being in the water. Seth pulls a sailing rope between his teeth, one hand on the rudder, the other now free to check his compass.
Come about. Switch!
Switch?
Suddenly Ryan sees the boom swinging right at his head.
Switching!
He ducks it, leaps across the boat to the other side. The boat changes direction, calms considerably.
Come on, relax. I mean, worst case scenario, you fall in.
I can't swim.
Seth's smile falls, the ocean never seeming so vast and threatening.
Well, I very rarely capsize, but just in case you should wear this.
He tosses Ryan a life jacket. Ryan grabs it, looks at it, embarrassed. Seth.
Oh, well, I should wear one too, here.
Later, the boat drifts in calmer waters. Not much action to speak of. Ryan, still unsettled, looks around. Seth is nervous for conversation, something to fill the silence.
So, first time sailing. You like it? I love it. I have this plan, or I don't know. I mean, you might think it's like whatever, but you know. Next July,
the trade winds, they shift west, and I want to sail to Tahiti. I mean, I could do it in 44 days, maybe even 42.
Wow, I mean, that's really
awesome, right? No rules, no map, except the sun and the stars. Maybe a sextant. Catch fresh fish off the side of the boat, grill them right there, just total quiet. Solitude.
You won't get lonely?
I mean, I'll have summer with me.
Ryan glances at the boat. Sees it's labeled the Summer Breeze.
You're gonna take this to Tahiti.
Oh no, the girl the boat's named after.
Oh. Oh, she must be stoked.
Yeah, she has no idea. I've never even talked to her before. We should get back.
Exterior cove later, the boys stand on a private cove, the catamaran beach before them. Seth de-rigs the boat, takes on the sails. Ryan tries tying the rope. Seth nudges him out of the way.
Here, counterclockwise, left hand over right.
He doesn't mean to be rude. It's just, this is his thing. Ryan gets it, backs off. Sandy comes down the trail, joining them.
Hey, guys. So, Seth, I thought we'd head over to the fashion show around 7.
Have fun.
Oh, come on. It's a new school year, Seth.
It's the same kids, Dad. Why do they even need a fashion show? Every day is a fashion show for these people. Yet another reason I wanted to go to boarding school. Everyone just wears uniforms.
Well, you know, Ryan has to go. Marissa invited him.
She did? I've lived next to Marissa forever. My mom and her dad almost got married, and she's never even invited me to her birthday.
Hey, they didn't almost get married.
Hey, maybe Summer will be there.
Well, she is best friends with Marissa. Interesting. 7?
Sandy nods. Without another word, Seth heads up off the trail to the house. Sandy gives Ryan a nod, appreciates the help.
So who is this Summer girl?
I wouldn't worry about it.
Set off behind Seth, high angle shot of Ryan, Sandy, and Seth heading up the trail, reverse reveal, Marissa, standing at her bedroom window, watching them, intrigued. The doorbell rings. Front door, Marissa opens it. Marissa walks the door, rings again and again.
I'm coming.
She opens the door to reveal two men in bad brown suits, Len and Steve, definitely not Newport. And it's clear from Marissa's face, she's seen these men before, and they frighten her. She blocks the door with her body.
My dad's not here.
Uh-huh. Well then, please remind him again how much we'd like to talk. We'd appreciate even a call back. I'll give you another one of my cards.
On the card, and the only part we need to see, Securities and Exchange Commission.
What's this about, anyway?
Not your concern. Have a good day.
Marissa closes the door, turns to see her 12-year-old sister, Caitlin, standing there.
Who's that?
Nobody.
It wasn't nobody. I heard you talking to
somebody. Don't worry about it. Go, get ready.
You can't tell me what to do.
Okay, don't get ready.
Caitlin, flummoxed by this logic. Frustrated, she storms off. Off Marissa looking at the card in her hand. Interior Cohen House master bedroom bathroom. Late afternoon. Oh, this is a deleted scene. Okay. Sandy in a suit, pops his cufflinks. Kirsten's in a gown. Beautiful. The bedroom is massive.
What do you care about what the Coopers think?
I'm just saying, how would you like to explain our guest? Will you zip me up?
Oh, yeah, sure. Say he's a cousin, you know, from Seattle or Boston. Or we could just skip it. Stay home.
Like father, like son.
You think we made the right decision not letting him go to boarding school because...
We're not shipping Seth off to some dumping ground for parents who don't want to raise their kids. Those places have no real supervision. There's drugs, drinking.
That doesn't go on here?
We're here.
A beat, Sandy nods, kisses her forehead. He backs off, backs out. Interior Seth's bedroom. Seth sits at his desk, not yet dressed, map open. He's making notations in the margins, checking longitude, charting his trip. Focus. Sandy knocks on the door. Seth shoves the map in the drawer so his dad won't see.
Hey, what are you doing?
SAT prep. Just working on my vocab.
Uh-huh. Well, come on. You got a shower. Get dressed.
Seth nods, turns away. Sandy stands there a beat, staring at his son's back. A familiar sight. He walks off. Interior of the Cohen Pool House, late afternoon. Ryan stands in front of a closet mirror in a pinstripe suit, hair combed. The kid cleans up real nice. He currently struggles with a tie, hanging limp around his neck. No idea what to do with it. And then folds it up and sticks it in his breast pocket. There's a knock on the door.
Come in.
Hey, look at that. Fits beautifully. Oh, but where's your tie?
Oh, I'm not going to wear one. Open collar. It's a great look.
You know, I didn't know how to tie a tie until I was 25.
Sandy extends his hand. Ryan hands over the tie. Sandy lays the tie over Ryan, standing behind him.
You know, now it's important that the skinny side be shorter than the fat side. And then we loop it up and watch.
Sandy goes through the steps. Ryan, not used to this kind of presence, watches the tie being made, but also watches their reflection in the mirror. To someone who didn't know better, they could be father and son.
And voila. Or not. Actually, that's terrible. Let's try it again. So, you got to spend some time with Seth. Was he... How did it... Was it... He's an interesting kid, you know? If you get to know him.
He's cool.
He's cool? Huh. All right, there we go. Look at ya.
Off the reflection, Sandy proud. Even Ryan's impressed. He could be from this world. Interior Cooper House, foyer late afternoon. Marissa comes down the stairs, dressed for the evening. Her mom, Julie, stands in front of the mirror, applying lipstick, checking her hair, as usual. Julie isn't a natural, not anymore anyway. Fake everything, tan skin becoming leathery. But thinks she's 40 going on 16. Caitlin stands next to her, imitating her mom, lipstick and all. Marissa takes a moment to experience this. Jimmy Cooper, 40s, devastatingly handsome.
Are you guys ready?
Do you guys like my hair this straight, or is it too Avril Lavigne?
No. It looks good, Mom.
This is gonna be so amazing tonight. Everyone's going. Are you gonna wear the Donna Karan, Maris? Didn't she look great in it, Jimmy?
Great.
Jimmy nods, opens the front door, hoping this will get everyone out of the house.
Those men came by again, Dad. What's going on?
I told you, it's just a client. You have nothing to worry about. You look beautiful, kiddo.
Aw, Tate saying kiddo again. It gives me the chills.
I really do.
Gives me the feels. All right.
Pay attention to your sister tonight, Caitlin, because this will be you in 4 years.
Aren't you excited? You have so much to look forward to.
Exterior, St. Regis pool, dusk. Ryan exits the lobby out to the spectacular pool area. The Cohen family in tow immediately stops in his tracks, and rightfully so. As lavish and opulent a hotel as exists in Southern California, a cellist plays in the corner. Feels like something for heads of state. Instead, it is filled with Newport's wealthiest denizens. Every ear, neck, and wrist glimmers gold and silver. Everyone white, but tan. The whole scene is like something from Gatsby. Ryan is overwhelmed. A waiter approaches, holding a tray of hors d'oeuvres.
Mushroom leek croissant, crab and brie phyllo.
On Ryan, are those foods? Seth arrives next to him, looks handsome, but doesn't quite fill out his suit.
Welcome to the dark side.
Exterior St. Regis pool, dusk, various shots of Ryan meeting various Newporters, like a pinball, bouncing from one to the next.
So, you're the cousin from Boston, huh? I could never live there, I just hate the cold. Do you like Seattle? I mean, all that rain, isn't it depressing?
Did I hear you say you were from Canada?
Canada, yeah.
Ryan with a Newport dad, 40s, aging well, fit.
You look at the ass here? Dude, don't ever get married. Whose kids do you say you were again?
All this intercut with exterior St. Regis pool dust. Marissa knows everyone, lights up every conversation, has wonderful poise with adults, kisses every cheek. Exterior St. Regis pool dusk. On Sandy, looks at Seth as he stands in the corner trying to disappear. Sandy watches him shift uncomfortably, not sure what to make of this kid, his son. Back to Seth as he's approached by a woman, Mrs. Donnelly, with a boy, Chester, 11.
Seth, Chester is loving his sailing lessons. He just loves going to the yacht club. Don't you, Chester?
Chester nods, gazing in awe up at Seth, his hero.
Uh-huh. Well, good. Yes, he is, Chester. He is doing great. Yes.
Well,
Mrs. Dunn, oops, sorry.
I know he's counting the days until his next lesson. Take care.
She and Chester walk off, Chester smiling and gazing lovingly. Seth exhales, relieved this conversation is over. Exterior, St. Regis pool, dusk. Ryan cuts to the crowd, gets to the bar, looks at the bartender, thinks about it, and then...
Hey, can I get a 7-7?
The bartender nods, pours Ryan his drink, hands it to him. Ryan turns, drink in hand, suddenly facing Kirsten. How long has she been standing there? She takes the drink from him.
Thanks. How'd you know? I want my husband to be right about you.
On Ryan nods, gets it. Suddenly, Newport woman number two, Mrs. Milano, approaches.
Hey, Kirsten, I was wondering if I could steal your nephew for a moment. There's someone I want him to meet.
Sure, go ahead.
Marissa, sweetie, I want you to meet somebody. This is Ryan.
Hi, Ryan. So nice to meet you.
Uh-huh. You too.
An absurd woman, overdressed, wearing an awful hat, air kisses an equally awful friend of hers.
So, what do you think of Newport?
Marissa, Reverend Donahue would like to say hello.
Oh, okay, Daddy, I'll be right with you. Back to work.
Yeah.
Exterior St. Regis pool night, Seth and Ryan by a table, Luke standing by them, grabbing a handful of hors d'oeuvres. A buddy of his passes by, Nordland. Blonde, big, they knock fists and then twist.
Lock it up, Norland.
Lock it up, Luke.
A beat, Seth next to Luke, alone. Seth has known Luke since second grade.
Hey, Luke.
Second queer.
Yeah. Ryan, my vacation looks... was great too, Luke. Thank you so much for asking.
On Seth as his eyes widen, throat goes dry.
Oh God, Summer. Summer. There, look, look, don't look. I mean, look, but don't look like you're looking.
Ryan looks across the room to see Marissa talking to Summer, 16. Summer's a lot like Marissa, only more. Bigger hair, chest, personality. She's checking out Ryan.
Who is that? The cousin, the pool boy, I don't know.
Well, I'm gonna find out.
Back to Seth and Ryan. Sandy arrives, sees the guy staring, points obliviously.
Is that Summer?
Oh God, I think it's time to sit.
He practically sprints off. Ryan gives Sandy a nod.
Oh, way to salt his game, Mr. Cohen.
Ryan follows after Seth, leaving Sandy alone, confused. As Ryan walks away, he passes Luke and Marissa, arms around each other. She giggles, pulls him towards her. Interior St. Regis ballroom night. Everyone is filed in, seated at round tables. Parents and kids not seated together. At the front of the room, a stage made to look like a catwalk. Marissa stands at the front of the stage at the microphone. As she quiets the room, everyone applauds.
Thank you all so much for coming. Every year, the National Charity League puts on a fashion show to raise money for the battered women's shelter, and we couldn't do any of it without your support and the support of Fashion Island and all their great stores. And dads, don't worry, just because your girls wear it, it doesn't mean they bought it. Your plastic is safe.
And with that, the lights dim and the music starts as everyone applauds for the first girl to come down the catwalk. Dressed handsomely in Armani, this whole enterprise is stately, sophisticated, ever so adult. Interior St. Regis, backstage continuous, a whole different story. A cacophony of shrill screams, arguing, hysteria, mothers and daughters battling, girls frantically ripping off what they're wearing to change. A carnival of vanity. In the midst of all of this, a fashion coordinator, female, icy 50, stands guard, charm checking every girl.
I knew we were here for a charity case. I just know that it was you.
What are you doing putting my daughter in Calvin Klein? She was supposed to wear Vera Wang.
And she would if she had the chest to hold it up. It's called puberty, honey. It'll happen.
Interior St. Regis, backstage bathroom. Marissa's applying a last round of lip gloss. Summer next to her, using a credit card to cut up a line of Coke on her compact mirror. Marissa looks at the reflection in the mirror, looking 10 years older than they are. They may have gotten cut. Not literally cut, like Summer's doing. Okay. An underclassman PA sticks her head in, clipboard in hand, wearing a headset.
Marissa, you're on.
As the PA runs off, Summer... Summer offers her the compact.
Careful, please. You want some of this? No, I'm cool. Thanks.
Off Summer shrugs and starts to bump a line herself. Okay. Interior St. Regis, ballroom night. It's Marissa's turn on the catwalk. Everyone applaud. Ryan, watching her, sitting with Seth and all the younger siblings of cool kids. Chester, Caitlin. Ryan's reverie is disrupted by Luke, standing at his table with his crew of Nordland and Saunders, etc., all whistling and cheering. And as Marissa turns towards him, posing for applause, she looks at Ryan and makes a face. Can you believe this? It's only for a moment, but Ryan catches it, smiles back. And Luke catches all of this himself, eyeballing Ryan for a moment. Until Saunders slaps him on the back, his boys hooting, catcalling. Luke gets up, back into the spirit of things, a last glance back at Ryan, who watches Marissa head off to the catwalk, turns to Seth.
I'll be right back.
Interior St. Regis Ballroom night, where Sandy and Kirsten sit with Jimmy and Julie Cooper and other couples.
She looks fabulous, you guys.
Too bad your wife and daughter have such inexpensive tastes.
That's why we trust him with our money. He's got to be doing something right.
Everyone laughs, except Jimmy. He forces a smile, then stares at his water glass, and it's like all sound is drowned out by his ice melting.
Jimmy, you okay?
Yeah, just stuffy in here. I'm gonna get some air.
Marissa wanted to wear these stiletto Milanos, but I said she had to wear the Prada Mary Janes.
Kirsten can't believe Julie's not more concerned with her husband. As she watches Jimmy walking out, she realizes Sandy is watching her watching Jimmy. She quickly looks away. Interior St. Regis men's room moments later, where Ryan is at the sink washing his hands. Jimmy brushes quickly past them into the bathroom stall. He closes the door, breathing deeply, sweating, his hand over his face. When he moves it away, there are tears in his eyes. Off Ryan, still at the sink, not sure what's going on exactly, but has a sense that not is all right. Not all is not right. Exterior St. Regis, drive-up night. The fashion show over. Everyone heading out. Parents handing off tickets to valets. Ryan follows behind Seth when Summer appears.
Hi. Where are you going? My friend Holly. Well, her parents are letting us use their beach house as a gift. You know, because of all of our hard work with charity. Mm-hmm. If you need a ride or anything. I'm Summer.
Seth comes back to claim Ryan.
Hey, there you are. Come on, let's get out of here.
No, we should go to that party at this girl Holly's.
Oh, No, that's not for us.
What, Summer just invited me.
She did? She invited you?
Well, us. She actually specifically invited us.
Really?
Yeah.
She did? That makes no sense, but...
On Summer climbing into the front seat of a convertible Bronco. She turns back to them, giving them a wave as she swings the door shut, and Seth is off immediately. Ryan follows him into the flatbed amongst a group of girls. As Ryan climbs in, he sees Marissa getting into Luke's Yukon. Ryan and Seth position themselves in the back of the flatbed, nodding awkwardly to their fellow passengers.
I mean, you know, we might as well check it out. If it sucks, we can always bail.
End of Act 2. Act 3, exterior beach house night. The truck arrives amongst madness. Kids streaming in from everywhere, music blasting. Ryan and Seth climb down last, lost in the sea of people. They have to make their way to allow a keg to roll through. As they snake through the front doors, interior beach house night, there's a group of kids gathered around a glass table doing more coke. Jesus, what was happening at this party? Okay. Suits, jackets off, ties loosened. Some kids in bathing suits, heads off to a hot tub.
Welcome to the dark side.
At the keg, and for some reason, there's always some guy who assigns himself the role of keg bro, so named for his predilection for the word bro. He's there now in a spooner, corduroy shorts, graduated high school a few years ago.
Yo, fresh keg, bro. You bros need a drink?
Yeah. Yeah? Yeah. Yes. Sure.
Sorry about the foam, bro. Check it. If you just swipe some oil off your nose and swirl it in your beard, no more foam.
Why would I want to drink oil from my nose?
Bro, I don't know.
Interior beach house bar night. Marissa pours some vodka into her cup, then some cranberry juice.
Oh, shit.
Summer and another girl, Holly, 16, arrive next to her.
Is that a new purse?
So cute.
Does your dad ever say no?
Marissa, tasting her drink, smiles weakly and then pours herself some more vodka. Hesitates. With two girls not watching her, Marissa pours some more.
Hey, look who I brought.
He's cute.
Marissa turns to see who they're talking about. Ryan, with Seth, awkwardly navigating the new social waters. As Ryan and Marissa's eyes are about to meet, Marissa turns away. Doesn't want her to see him. Tastes her drink instead. It's strong, but it'll do.
I'm gonna play him hot and cold. You wanna pee? I gotta pee.
As Marissa, Summer, and Holly disappear into the bathroom, on Luke, standing on the balcony overlooking the beach, sees Marissa close the door, turns to see the cute freshman girl standing with him.
Isn't it so beautiful, the sand and the water?
Yeah. You want to go check it out?
Yeah, but what about...
I don't know. No worries.
Off Nikki's look, there's no way she's saying no to him. On Ryan, tracks Luke with his eyes, leaving with some girl, Luke's hand on the small of this girl's back. Kirsten comes outside with a pair of garbage bags, throwing them in pails at the foot of, exterior Cohen house. Kirsten comes outside with a pair of garbage bags, throwing them in pails at the foot of the driveway, where she sees Jimmy walking their golden retriever, Dustin.
Jimmy, hey. Hey, Dustin. You... You really okay?
Yeah.
Because, you know, you can always...
I've just been working a lot, you know. Got to pay my wife's credit card bills.
Kirsten smiles, Jimmy does too. Realizes her hand has been on his arm for a beat or two too long.
So, who was that boy you brought tonight? I didn't know you had a cousin from Boston.
One of Sandy's clients. He's taking him in for the weekend.
Suddenly, the Cooper front door opens. Julie stands there.
Jimmy, did you get my froyo?
No, I forgot. I'll go back.
Pistachio. Thanks, sweetie. Hi, Kristen.
Froyo. Did you ever think this would be our lives?
Marissa back yet?
She's usually out till pretty late.
Seth's not usually out.
Don't worry. I'm sure they're not doing anything we didn't do.
That's reassuring.
Felt exactly the same when we did it. Same vibe. Seriously, I'm like transported, you know? Right?
Yeah.
The script says, oh God, but I watched the pilot this morning to prepare. And I took the blue pages.
Yeah, all right.
Sorry, just wanted to
clearly say. Not the pages with all the cocaine in them. Okay, interior. Beach house party night. Back to the party as the night rages on. Couples hooking up on stairs against the walls. random guy 16 taking pictures of one couple with his digital camera. That was a thing that didn't used to come with your phone.
2003.
His friends were hysterical. Okay, the beach house dance floor packed, and of course, someone always has a disco ball. That's not true. Groups of girls dancing, posing with each other. An expensive vase gets knocked over, shatters. No one bats an eye. An indoor hot tub filled with bubble steam and scantily clad kids. On a group of stoner surfer guys sitting on a couch, just staring, slack-jawed, not moving, and having a great night. On Ryan, standing by the bar, just trying to blend, Marissa comes over, eyes a little heavy.
So, you never told me. What do you think of Newport?
I think we can get in less trouble where I'm from.
You have no idea.
From the coffee table where a group of kids sit playing a drinking game.
Coop, it's your turn to deal.
Marissa takes her cup and then walks off, not so steadily. Okay, interior beach house night, a line of kids wait impatiently in front of a keg as Seth sits cross-legged on the floor, keg tipped in his direction. He works on the keg, unscrewing taps and hoses.
Okay, I see how this works. Okay, so the carbon dioxide from the tank is used to pressurize the keg. Interesting, interesting. And then you use the regulator to lower the pressure and voila. Huh?
He pours foamless beer into his cup.
See? No need for the nose oil. It's hard to say. No need for the nose oil.
He turns expectantly to see Keg Bro, who has passed out. A couple of kids draw on his face with a permanent marker.
More for me.
On Ryan, sipping his beer, surrounded by girls on cell phones, chattering incessantly, he shakes his hands, finishes his drink when Summer staggers out to him.
Look who I found. Oops. Hi.
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 Hey.
I'm wasted. So, what's your name, anyway?
Ryan.
So, I'm so wasted, Ryan. I need someone to take care of me, okay?
She has him up against the railing. Ryan doesn't know what to do. Laugh, go for it, run.
Okay, whatever.
Summer takes one finger, shushes him with it, and then leans in, going for a kiss.
Hey, you gotta check out the keg! I totally fixed it!
Wait, what are you guys, what are you doing?
No, wait, Seth, hey.
Excuse me.
Dude, what are you doing? I mean, I named my boat after her.
What? Ew, who are you?
No, dude, it's not what you think.
No.
Come on, Rai-Rai.
Rai-Rai?
Rai-Rai.
Man, I don't believe you.
People at the party are starting to take notice. Marissa looks up from her drinking game.
Dude, Seth, come on, man.
No, you know what? Why don't you just go back to Chino? I'm sure you can find a nice car in the parking lot to steal.
He shoves Ryan, not to much avail, and then charges out. A long, awkward beat, as it seems everyone in the room is staring at Ryan, outed. As Ryan sees Marissa looking at him, she looks away. Even in her state, she realizes what he told her last night is true.
Chino, ew.
She moves on to her new prey. Off Ryan standing there, everyone still eyeing him, and then he goes after Seth. Exterior beach, moments later, a bonfire burns, kids hanging out, and we see Seth trying to make his way past the bonfire, being harassed by four members of Luke's crew. They have him surrounded.
Go home, geek.
Who invited you, suck-ass?
Yeah, can't we just be friends? I mean, you know, lock it up, Nordland!
You joking me?
You ever been night surfing? Let's see how he does on a board.
Ryan leaves, not sure where to go next, as he sees Luke's crew grab Seth. One guy has his leg, another grabs his other leg. Ryan approaches.
You don't belong here, Cody.
I know. And if you just let me go, I promise I'll never come back.
Too late.
Hey! Put him down.
As Ryan gets closer, Luke emerges with Nikki from behind some nearby rocks, disheveled, her hair and makeup messed up. Ryan and Luke arrive at the squirming, screaming Seth and Luke's friends at the same time.
Let go, please! I'm sorry!
What's up, dude? You got a problem?
You tell me, dude.
Ryan swings hard, hits Luke right in the face. Seth's drop as the crew reprioritizes. There's a big fight scene, a lot of stuff happens. Ryan's doing his best, but he's pinned on the sand, taking kicks, shots to the head, fighting to get up. Luke breaks free, kicks Ryan in the groin. Ryan rides over. Luke kicks him again in the kidneys. He's eating sand now. Luke straightens, trying to adjust his clothes, wiping blood away from his mouth.
Welcome to ATX, bitch.
This is how it's done in Austin, Texas. If I ever see you here again, you're dead. You hear me? Dead!
Off Ryan and Seth hurting. Ryan rolls over to his back, tries to sit up, lays back down. Interior Cohen Pool House night. Ryan and Seth open the door, stumble in, bruised and battered. Each collapses onto a different bed.
I don't know what to say. Except tonight was unbelievable. I mean, you totally had my back. You were like out of Fight Club. You know, if you taught me a few moves, I think we could take them next time. And no, it wasn't exactly how I planned my first talk to Summer, but I am on her radar. Do you think I should tell her about Tahiti?
Not yet.
That's what I thought. What a night, man, you know? I'm never gonna forget it. I'm just, I think it's...
And Seth is unconscious. On Ryan, lies there, restless. Exterior Cohen House night, Ryan comes out to his spot at the end of the driveway, trying to stretch out his sore ribs. He takes a beat, enjoying the quiet and the peacefulness. And then an Escalade comes up the street, music blasting. The car lurches to a halt. A pair of girls get out of the car, Summer and Holly. They go around to the back passenger door, open it.
I can't believe her.
I swear to God, she's so retarded sometimes.
They gingerly try to extract a passed out Marissa from the back seat, draped over Holly. Summer stumbles behind. As they lead her to the front door, Ryan steps behind the bushes for cover.
Kip, where are your keys? How are we gonna find her keys?
If her parents see us, they'll kill us.
Shouldn't her boyfriend be doing this? God, he's so worthless. I can't find her keys.
Well, we can't wake her parents. Her dad'll freak out.
A beat as they look at each other, trying to figure out what to do. An unspoken consensus is reached. They lay her down on the front steps of the house.
Bye, Coop.
Call us. Okay.
They jump in Holly's truck and drive away. On Ryan, can't believe it. He walks across the lawn to Marissa's front door. He tries gently shaking her.
Hey, come on. Come on, I need your keys.
Nothing. He opens her purse, rifling through quickly. Still nothing. A moment as he thinks this through. Exterior Cohen backyard night. Ryan carries Marissa across the backyard, draped over his shoulder. Interior Cohen house, pool house. Moments later, he comes in. Seth is still out. Ryan sets Marissa down on his bed, takes off her shoes, and sits there for a beat, just watching her. End of act three. Act four, interior Cohen pool house, morning. On Seth, sound asleep. On Ryan on the floor, his suit jacket doubling as a pillow. He stirs, sits up, turns to look at the other bed. Empty. Not a trace of Marissa. Ryan only has a moment to register this when there's a pounding at the door.
Seth? Seth, are you in there? Oh, thank God. What happened to your face?
I got into a fight. It happens.
What? With who? Why?
I don't really know. I was drunk. I think I still am.
Kirsten doesn't know whether she should scream or cry. She grabs Seth, pulling him up.
Let's go house now.
She almost shoves him out the door and shoots Ryan a cold look before she slams the door. Off Ryan, knowing he's in trouble. Exterior Cohen house, driveway morning. Sandy in a wetsuit unloads a surfboard from the back of the Range Rover. Kirsten charges outside.
Oh, you should see the swells coming in. 8-foot waves.
Seth got into a fight.
He did? Huh.
This is what happens when you invite someone like that into our house. When you let our son hang out with criminals.
Well, at least he has someone to hang out with. Don't salt his game, Kirsten.
What does that mean?
I have no idea. What I do know is I would rather Seth hang out with Ryan than with some trust fund kid who only cares about getting his new Beamer. There's a real world out there, outside this Newport Beach bubble.
You don't seem to mind living in this bubble.
That's because I know there's something else out there. Remember when we were 22 and you said you'd never be like your parents, never have their life?
I was 22. I stank of patchouli and lived in the back of a mail truck.
You were fun. You were rebellious. You married me.
I'm sorry. I can't. I don't want this kid in my home anymore.
Where is he supposed to go?
He has a family, and it's not for you to say whether or not they're good enough.
Interior Cohen kitchen morning. Ryan stands by the sink in the kitchen, gazing out the window. Kirsten storms in, finds Ryan there.
Look, Ryan, I don't mean to play bad cop. Is that bacon?
She looks at the stove, surprised to see bacon sizzling, pancakes cooking, a bowl of egg yolks.
Rose is not on today.
Yeah, I made it. I usually make breakfast at my house. My mom's not really a cook, so...
I'm sorry. You seem like a nice kid.
It's okay. I get it.
Ryan picks up his bag, already packed.
You have a really nice family.
Ryan exits, off Kirsten's look, unflinching. Interior Seth's bedroom morning. Ryan knocks on the door, Seth in bed, trying to sleep it off. Sits up when Ryan comes in.
Hey, man. So, I got a jet.
You're leaving? Oh, my head. My first hangover. Interesting. Wait, what's up?
Yeah, I gotta get back. Got some things I gotta figure out back at home.
Cool. I mean, not cool, but, well.
Ryan extends his hand. Seth, suddenly emotional, throws his arms around Ryan instead. A beat. It's clear Ryan hasn't been hugged very often.
I'll come down to Chino, and I'll visit you. You could show me your world.
Uh-huh.
Oh, wait.
Seth suddenly moves to his desk, opens the drawer, pulls out his weathered map, hands it to Ryan.
Here, maybe there's some place you want to go. It's good for ideas.
Off their shared smile, Joseph Arthur's Honey in the Moon. Exterior Cohen House, interior Mercedes morning. Sandy and Ryan back in the Mercedes, backing out of the driveway. As they do, Ryan sees Marissa, standing at the bottom of her driveway, looking at her. You'd have no idea the night she had, waiting for her friends. And she sees Ryan, and in her eyes, it's clear. She knows what he did for her last night, and she's grateful. As they hold on to each other for a beat, Sandy sees this, has no choice but to drive off. Ryan looks back, and Marissa's watching the car drive off as she gets smaller and smaller in the distance. Exterior Pelican Cove, interior Mercedes, morning. The wrought iron gates swing the other way. The security guard watches them, gives a wave. Exterior PCH, interior Mercedes, morning. Ryan and Sandy drive in silence again. Ryan getting his last glimpse of the beauty in this town. Off his reflection in the window. Exterior Chino City streets. They drive on. The view is transformed back into the cold gray remoteness of his home. Exterior Ryan's shitty house, morning. Sandy pulls the car up to Ryan's house, getting his first glimpse of it. The disparity between the two houses, remarkable.
So, thanks for everything.
Oh, I'm gonna make sure everything works out, Ryan. I promise.
Ryan nods, he knows that, a beat. They get out of the car. Sandy helps Ryan take his bike from the trunk. As Ryan heads up the driveway, Sandy follows.
It's okay. I can take it from here. I got a lot of explaining to do.
That did not make it into the actual final pilot.
I can't see Ben doing that.
Yeah, Ben McKenzie doing Desi Arnaz or Lucy. Okay.
Exterior. Almost as good as what I just did.
Yeah, pretty good. Exterior, Ryan's shitty house continuous. Ryan takes a long walk up to his house. With every step he takes, his lump in his throat gets larger. Ryan pulls out his keys, his hand shaking. He takes a deep breath, sticks the key in the lock, and the door swings wide open. Interior, Ryan's shitty house continued. The house is cleaned out. Nothing. A few boxes left on Ryan. Can't quite believe it. He sees a paper towel on one of the boxes with scrawl on it, the note. He walks over to it, sees Dear Ryan written at the top, crumples it, a beat, and then he realizes Sandy's standing in the doorway.
Come on, let's go.
Ryan nods, following Sandy out, as Ryan closes the door on his empty, abandoned home. Fade out.
California, here we come.